Blackstone Publishing presents What the Dead Leave Behind by David Housewright. This book is read by Brent Hinkley. For Renee, if I said it once, I've said it 17 times. 1. The way he paced recklessly in front of me, bouncing off furniture, tripping on the throw rug, the way he looked at me with unblinking eyes, I decided the kid was messed up. My only question, was it a temporary condition possibly brought on by pharmaceuticals or permanent? It's been a year, he said, a year, and no one's done anything. I was sitting in a chair. He halted in front of me and waved his fist. The effort caused his body to sway uncertainly. Anything, he repeated. Malcolm, Erica said. She patted the cushion next to her. Please. He turned reluctantly and moved to the sofa. He didn't sit so much as collapse as if all the weight of the world was forcing him down. Erica took his hand in hers, and I noticed for the first time that his knuckles were scraped and a couple of drops of blood had dried in the creases between his fingers. It'll be all right, she told him. No, it won't, he said. Erica squeezed his hand and he sighed. His eyes closed with the sigh, and she gazed at him with such affection that for a moment I felt anxious. What the hell was this kid to her, I wondered. Besides being a good-looking boy who was in trouble that a strong woman like her might be able to help him with. I had known Erica since I had become involved with her mother. Has it really been over 6 years now? I watched her evolve from an awkward, nerdy teen into a beautiful, smart-as-hell young woman who was a year away from earning both a Bachelor of Arts and a Bachelor of Science degree from Tulane University. I had never known her to look at anyone like she looked at Malcolm. McKenzie will help, she said. You will? My inner voice asked. Won't you? Erica said. Yeah, probably. What do you need? I asked. Be specific. Malcolm's eyes snapped open, and he practically leapt from the sofa. He was taller than I was, but thin and pale, and I wondered, how could anyone going to school in New Orleans be pale? He began pacing again. I came this close to telling him to sit his ass back down, but resisted. I knew Erica wouldn't like it. You're a detective, he said. Ricky said you're a detective. Ricky? In a manner of speaking, I said. Well, are you or aren't you? I don't have a license, if that's what you're asking. Then how can you help? Malcolm's voice was suddenly high and out of control. I never said I could. Ricky told me. He made a noise in his throat that might have been a sob. He stopped pacing and gazed at his damaged hand as if seeing it for the first time. How did that happen? I asked. What? Your hand. Malcolm hit it behind his back. None of your business, he told me. Okay. I watched him. He watched me. What? He asked again. Just waiting. For what? For you to tell me the reason why you're here. While we wait, would you like something to drink? Coffee? Dr. Pepper? We got milk. I'm 21. You say that like you're old. Old enough to drink. Have you been drinking? No, I guess I'm not making a very good impression, am I? Something my mother said earlier kind of threw me. Mr. McKenzie, I don't do drugs and I don't drink. Not a lot, anyway. Well, I'm going to have something. Erica? Nothing for me, thank you, she said. The high-rise condominium that Erica's mother and I shared in downtown Minneapolis was wide open. We didn't have rooms so much as areas. Dining area, TV area, a music area where Nina's Steinway stood. The entire north wall was made of tinted floor-to-ceiling glass with a dramatic view of the Mississippi River. If that wasn't enough, there was a sliding glass door built into the wall that led to a balcony that I almost never use because I'm afraid of heights. The south wall featured floor-to-ceiling bookcases that turned at the east wall and followed it to a large brick fireplace. To the left of the fireplace was a door that led to a guest bedroom with its own full bath that Erica used whenever she was in town. Against the west wall, and elevated 3 steps above the living area was the kitchen area. Beyond that was a master bedroom that also featured floor-to-ceiling windows. I moved to the kitchen area. I found a Summit Pale Ale in the refrigerator, popped the cap, took a long pull from the bottle, and settled on a stool at the island. From there, I was able to look down into the living area. Erica and Malcolm could see and speak to me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.